Hello. I want us to spare some time and discuss the methodology research. Today, I want us to focus on three important items that are very critical in methodology. These are population, unit of analysis, and data. Kindly pay a lot of attention to these issues because they form an important foundation of what we are likely to encounter in our subsequent discussions under methodology. Welcome. Let's begin with the concept population. In research, population refers to individuals, objects, or institutions which the research intends to focus on. In other words, the aggregates of individuals or people or objects that will be the concern of the study is what in research we call population. It is different from the population the way it is understood in geography or in our normal discussion, where it refers to the number of people living in a given area. In research, it basically refers to the people, the individuals, the objects or institutions that the study will focus on. There are two types of population as far as research is concerned. These are target population and accessible population. What do we exactly mean by each of these? Target population refers to the entire group of individuals or objects which the researcher is interested in. For instance, if I want to carry out, say, a study on the popularity of presidential candidates in a given general election, then my population, the target population, will be all the individuals in a country that are allowed by law to take part in an election. In this case, there will be individuals who are aged 18 years and above, according to the Kenyan Constitution, and are also registered as voters. That will be the target population. In other words, it is the entire group of individuals that we seek to understand their opinion, perspectives, or perception on any given issue that we have set out to study. Then we have what we call the accessible population. Accessible population is a population research in which the researcher draws its sample from. It is also called the study population. For instance, if, say, I want to undertake a study about the popularity of presidential elections, say in Kenya, bearing in mind that Kenya is earmarked to have a general election in 2022, in the month of August, then my accessible population will be the registered voters in a given constituency or in the entire country, and which I'm sure from that population I will get the sample whose opinions will now directly constitute my research report. The other concept that we also need to discuss and understand is what we call unit of analysis. The unit of analysis in research refers to the person, collective, or object which is the target of the study. In other words, it is an entity that a researcher wishes to say something about at the end of the study. And it's also considered the focus of the study. The unit of analysis is basically the frames, the entity that frames what is being looked at in a study, or is an entity that is being studied as a whole. A unit of analysis can be an individual, groups, organizations, countries, technologies, or objects. For instance, assuming we want to understand factors contributing to labor unrest in our institutions of learning, with a special reference to our universities in Kenya, then our unit of analysis will be the university, because we want to understand the perspective of the university with regard to what these strikes mean to them and what they think causes these strikes. Or another example, for instance, assuming we want to look at what is leading to students engaging in drug abuse at universities, then in this case, the students becomes our unit of analysis. Therefore, unit of analysis is simply the entity through which the research wants to use its voice to raise its concerns to the public, its concerns to the society about what is happening in a particular society. Let's then look at yet another important concept or terminology that is used in research, especially at the methodology level, and this is data. Data is any information which has been collected to validate research findings. It may also be defined as a recorded, factual material accepted by the scientific community as being relevant in qualifying research findings. Data may include field questionnaires, field notebooks, transcripts, field observation checklists, audio tapes, video tapes, photographs, films, among others. Data comes in many types. We have what we call primary and secondary data as one way of categorizing data. What do each of these mean? Primary data is any information, or rather, primary data is any original information gathered for purposes of answering the research problem. It is an original and unique data which is directly collected from the source. For instance, if we want to establish why students are engaging in strikes, then our primary data will be information that is obtained from the students. Then we have what is called secondary data. Secondary data is any information which is already collected by other researchers, such as government publications and previous scholarly studies. For instance, if we want to understand why students are engaging in strikes, then we might decide to read government reports on strikes in our schools. We might read other studies that have been carried out by scholars, both locally and internationally, and we might also want to look at papers that have been presented in various conferences on education, which are focusing on student unrest in our institutions of learning. So all that information that we don't obtain directly from the primary sources or from the respondents themselves, that information or that data, we call it secondary data. Secondary data may also refer to the data which has already been collected for a certain purpose and documented by other entities other than the current researcher. Of course, that definition is simply helping us to enlighten us more with regard to what is meant by secondary data. Data can also be classified as discrete and continuous. Discrete data is one which can be recorded into whole numbers only. For example, the number of students in a given college can only be recorded in whole numbers. For instance, we can say College A has 400 students, College B has 500 students, has 20,000 students, has 15,000 students, and so on and so forth. We cannot at any point describe the population of students in any given school as being, say, 50 and a half. So discrete data is data in which we can only record them in whole numbers only. The number of students, the number of children in a given family are examples of discrete data. Then we have what we call continuous data. This is data which can be recorded or processed into fractions or decimal points. For instance, data on weight, so that somebody can weigh 90.5 kilograms, on temperature, on height. All these variables, their data, or rather the measurement, can be given both in fraction and decimal points. So any data that we can record in form of fractions and decimal points, that data, we call it continuous data. Another important set of data or type of data is called nominal data. Nominal data refers to data which can be placed into categories based on a defined criteria or trait. It should be noted that some data are suited to be placed in categories such as gender, which we can categorize as male or female. Employment status, which we can categorize as employed or unemployed. Disease infection status, which we can categorize as being positive or negative. Students' campus residential status, which we can categorize as residential or non-residential. So any data that we can put in form of categories, we call that data nominal data. Nominal data is regarded as the lowest form of data because it does not capture information about the final attributes of an object, rather than whether the object belongs or does not belong to a given category. Therefore, when you look at data on employment status, you can be employed, you can simply be employed or unemployed. But in between, there are other probably other categories of employment. Are you formally employed? Are you casually employed? Are you self-employed? Or what status of unemployment or other employment are you? Therefore, when we use nominal data, there are other information that is probably missing. Nominal data does not permit the application of the four mathematical functions, meaning that nominal data cannot be subjected to addition, subtraction, division, and multiplication. So, like male or female, we cannot subject them to those mathematical functions. Then we have what we call ordinal data. Ordinal data is data which can be ranked in ascending or descending order. For example, level of education can be ranked in ascending order from primary, secondary, college, and university, or vice versa. Military ranks can also be ranked in ascending and descending order. Job ranks the same. So any data that we're in a position to rank in order of ascendancy or descendancy, that data we call it ordinal data. Although richer than nominal data, ordinal data still suffers from some information loss in the data, such as the distance between the ranked data. For instance, what is the distance between primary and secondary level of education, or between secondary and college level of education, or between college and university level of education? Again, ordinal data does not permit the application of the four mathematical functions, that is addition, subtraction, division, and multiplication. It does not permit the use of this particular data. Therefore, we cannot, for instance, say that if you have university education, then you are three times or four times more educated than primary, than a person who went up to primary level education, because this kind of data cannot be subjected to the four mathematical functions. The other type of data is called interval data. Interval data indicates the distance one object is from another object. It allows for the degree of difference between items, since it permits the application of the four mathematical functions. Examples of interval data are age, weight, income, distance, or any other data where we can apply the four mathematical functions. If, say, we take the example of age, somebody, person A, can be twice older than person B, or half, or 2 years older, 3 years older, or 1 year younger, 5 years younger, 10 years younger. So when it comes to interval data, we can apply with confidence the four mathematical functions. So any data where we can apply the four mathematical functions, that data, it is called interval data. The last type of data is called ratio data. Ratio data refers to data that has all the information of other types of data that we have discussed, including absolute zero. In other words, zero is counted as a number. It is regarded as the richest and highest form of data measurement. Ratio data permits the application of all the mathematical functions, including absolute zero. For instance, an example of ratio data is temperature. Temperature, 0 degrees, is counted as temperature. Negative 1, negative 2, or temperature below zero are still counted as temperature. So any data that permits the four mathematical functions and in which zero is also counted as a number, that data is called ratio data. That is the end of our discussion. And as usual, I still want to encourage you to note down any information that is not clear or which you feel we need further discussions, and we shall spare time and look at them comprehensively during our normal lecture, face-to-face lecture hours. Thank you. Hello. I want us to spare some time and discuss the methodology research. Today, I want us to focus on three important items that are very critical in methodology. These are population, unit of analysis, and data. Kindly pay a lot of attention to these issues because they form an important foundation of what we are likely to encounter